So we are very happy to have you, and we look forward to your presentation. And this, yeah, the goal of Ag Science on Tap is to present research to non-experts or experts that may not be in your specific field, but is nevertheless super interesting and super important. And just looking over at your website, I see that you are a rock star and doing very cool research. So I'm so happy that Claudia invited you and you agreed to be our first presenter. And so I think I will hand it over to Claudia to introduce you for our room and for our Zoom, our YouTube room.
Okay, maybe next slide. I don't know what comes next. Oh, this is just like a little bit on what Hans Eisenmann Forum is to everyone who doesn't know it, because we are the co-host here, and Hans Eisenmann Forum is a central institution of TU Munich, which networks all the agricultural chairs within TUM and outside TUM. And besides initiating research projects in hot topic fields like vertical farming or robot farming and agroforestry and climate change, we also do a lot of outreach events. And this is one of them. We try to get agricultural topics into the society and also discuss the topics. So this is real quick what we are. And now we want to see who is here today. Oh, we start first with what's coming up next. So this was actually your part. Okay. Wanna go?
All right, I will go. So before we introduce our speaker, we'll introduce the series of Ag Science on Tap this semester, where we are again doing another series of meeting women in the agricultural sciences. So this was a big success last semester, where we had women across all disciplines working in agricultural research, from the ecological perspective, from the technological perspective, and from the social perspective. And so the next for this semester, we have four talks. The first is hooking up plants to sensors to reveal their mysteries. And that is what we will hear today. And then the next three talks will actually be in person here in Furtnerbräu, where we have Dr. Julia Schmack. I'm very excited. This is a member of our group, and she will be talking about the good, the bad, and the ugly insects in agriculture. So all of the people that are in this room should definitely be there to support Julia. We also will have Dr. Annette Freibauer on December 8th, and she will be talking about soil conservation. And we will also have on January 19th, Sarah Leonard. And she will be talking about bees in agricultural landscapes and also their importance for pollination. So we invite you all to take part in this series, hopefully presence, but also of course digital. And now I will turn it over to Claudia to introduce our speaker.
So let's skip the next slide because we see her in person, and give me the next slide. So just a real quick introduction of our today's speaker. We have Kati Steppe from Belgium here, from the University of Ghent, and she is a professor of bioscience engineering and is specialized in applied plant ecophysiology. And today she's going to talk about plant sensors, which is one of her hot topics. And she's working on plant sensors and mechanistic plant models to study the response of crops and trees in the environment. And she also develops early warning stress detection systems. But I think today we are basically working, hearing something about sensors and what plants are trying to tell us, right? So the floor is yours, the digital floor.
Okay, thank you so much also for the very kind and nice introduction. So I will first try to share my screen. Okay, do you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So good evening, all of you in the room with hopefully a cold beer. So enjoy while I try to take you a bit in the story of hooking up plants to sensors to reveal their mysteries. So indeed, due to the risk of corona, I could not come, but here you see a bit how far we are apart from each other. you with the cool beers. I am here and so live streaming from Ghent University, the Faculty of Bioscience Engineering. So Claudia also asked me to introduce a little bit my career and where we are now. And so I started my studies in 1995 at the Faculty of Bioscience Engineering. And I graduated as a Master of Science in Bioscience Engineering Environmental Technology. And basically my research started during my master studies when I did my master thesis research. And I was lucky because in the year that I did my master thesis in 1999 already, there was a solar eclipse, a full solar, like almost full solar eclipse in Belgium. And at that moment, trees were hooked up with sensors and I could there measure the dynamic water transport in a beech tree. It was only one tree, one repetition, but given the specific phenomenon, we managed to get that published. So everything started basically from there, solar eclipse. Water is dynamically transporting in plants, and that fascinated me. So I decided indeed and got the chance to do my PhD in applied biological sciences. That is the degree that was at that time handed out by our faculty. And so over 4 years, I spent time with using all kinds of plant sensors, of which I will introduce some in the coming slides. And basically you can see it a bit as an intensive care environment, not for humans, but for plants. And then towards the second part of my PhD, I also moved into mechanistic plant modeling, and there developed a turgor-driven growth model that can be run at the full plant scale. Then I continued with two postdocs, and the first one basically took the plant sensors and the plant models that were more or less fundamental in application into an applied research. And we developed a software tool for automatic control of irrigation. And if you put the first letters after each other, that ends up with STACI. So STACI was indeed an irrigation control system that we developed. And then later on, the base is there. So the combination of plant sensors and plant models then gave rise to a spin-off company of the Laboratory of Plant Ecology, which I'm currently leading and from which I'm scientific advisor. And the spin-off company is called PhytoIT. So that was like, let's say, a spin-off of the postdoc that I run there. During that time, I also continued further to study radial stem growth, so linking water and carbon dynamics. And still now we do that. So we look both at the water relations as well as to the carbon relations. And it's by the interaction of both domains that new things basically can be found. And during that period, I also, because you see that my whole timeline is at Ghent University, but during that timeline, I also spent some months at several institutes as an international visiting researcher. And in October 2008, I got the chance to become the head of the Laboratory of Plant Ecology. And since then, I moved on in my professor career. And since 2000, I will maybe close this. Since 2018, I am full professor at the Faculty of Bioscience Engineering, Ghent University, and still running the Laboratory of Plant Ecology. Okay, so we are basically driven by this quote, only those who can see the invisible can do the impossible. And you see here indeed intensive care images. And basically that is what we as bioengineers also want to do. So we want to listen to the plant's heartbeat, let's say, because plants cannot speak in with words, but if we understand their signals, we can let them speak to us and we can understand their stories. We are also looking for early warning signs. And in that sense, basically, we get the dialogue started between plants and ourselves as applications that we want to use. And here you see that we truly hook plants up with sensors. So you see here a wheat crop with dendrometers and a subflow sensor. Here a tree equipped with sensors. This even looks like acupuncture, let's say. Here we also use medical techniques, PET, positron emission tomography, techniques that we use to visualize sugar transport in plants. And then here, this speaks for itself, I think. So this is a combination of cephalo sensors and carbon relations and a lot of wires, as you can see. So intensive care environment for plants to better understand them and to study the response of the plant to their environment. So I took that as a topic to show you that we can reveal the plant's mysteries, and we can do that in several settings. So we can do that in forest, in vertical farms, and in space. So I will give you an idea how we in the lab do that in these different domains. And let me start with the revealing of the mysteries in forest. And for that, we equip basically the tree with a sap flow sensor. So as the word says, it measures the sap flow. And for that, we use basically sensors that release a heat pulse in the stem. And then you see here these other two needles above and below, and those measure the heat field. And so heat basically is used as a tracer for the movement of sap. So that is in short how a sap flow sensor works. And then we have also a point dendrometer, which we put on the organ, in this case, the stem. And if the stem grows, then there will be a linear translation of this growth. And we can measure that with a point dendrometer. And these two sensors together, they form basically a bit, I previously said the heartbeat sensor of the plant, but my son is asking for a Fitbit. And so let's say that it becomes the Fitbit for the tree. So we hook it up, we send the data through the cloud so that we can follow live the trees. And what makes it interesting is that then the tree becomes a biological indicator. And that's quite important because we measure on the plant itself to tell us, to inform us how the plant feels, how the performance is. And this concept we then run out in the TreeWatch concept. And here you see a screenshot of the website. So also, if you are interested, you can go to it and then you can see the different locations where we have trees. Also in Bavaria, so it might be nice to have a look for you at those ones. So they are all equipped with this set of sensors, and they send their data live to the cloud so that we as researchers can see them. So that means that we use these data for creating scientific papers. Here, for example, you see a tree that is equipped in the Faculty of Bioscience Engineering. Over the last 2, 4, 5 years, both sap flow patterns and the 5 consecutive growing patterns during the years. You can also zoom in. But on the other hand, we also can create with this network societal impact, because this tree, for example, at the Faculty of Bioscience Engineering, it has its own Twitter account, and you can receive tweets. How much water does the tree consumes? How much growth was there? Is there an impact of, for example, a heat wave? So the tree speaks there literally to us through an interpretation of the signals. And I must say, such a tree, if you hook it up to Twitter, it gets a lot of followers. So I don't compare it to my own Twitter account, because otherwise it would be a bit embarrassing. So, but just to say that with the same data where you can have scientific impact, that you can also inform the general public. So by measuring the sap flow and the growth, basically we can say something about water relations and sugar transport. And therefore they form this Fitbit for the trees, because that are the water transport and sugar transport are basically the two main processes that help plants to grow. So to give you a bit an idea, here you see a tree equipped with a sap flow sensor sending the data. And as soon as there is transpiration, here you see a stomata in at the leaf level. So if the stomata are open, the water vapor escapes. And due to this water vapor escaping, there will be water molecules that are pulled up in the vessel. So this is a vessel that, and there are many, many, many vessels in such a stem. Here you see a micro CT image of a stem of an ash tree. And here you see all the active water columns, as you see here, one water column. And so the water molecules, they are continuously moving up inside this stem, right? And you see that, why is that? Because indeed we have transpiration, and that is the cohesion between the water molecules pulls up the water molecules. And therefore, if we release then heat here by the sensor, and the heat is transported with the sap flow, we can measure then how much sap is flowing through the stem. And if we do that and we measure that, then we get these kind of patterns, which we can see in also live on the website, for example, on TreeWatch. You can follow these patterns. And here you see that sometimes it's higher. So this is during the day, sometimes it's lower. And that is due to clouds that come before the sun, and therefore you have this dynamic pattern. And if you integrate then the values under these curves, then you exactly know how much water that a tree has consumed. So you can now compare how much beers you need to drink to have the same amount of liquid as this tree that we measured. So, and you see also that that differs depending on the day and the microclimate. If we then add, besides the sap flow sensor, a dendrometer, then we get patterns like this. And here you nicely see that if the transpiration is larger than the uptake of water through the roots, then basically you pull out more water from the stem and the stem will shrink. And you see that the shrinkage happens during the day. So that means if you go to the forest and you walk there, and you do that around midday, that the trees will be smaller than when you had your walk or your run in the early morning. So therefore, you basically, if you walk in the forest during midday, they should be smaller. Of course, we cannot see it by the bare eye, because you see the numbers that we measure, a shrinkage is here like around 40 micrometers. So that can go up to 200 micrometers, but it is in the micrometer range. So really, but it's small shrinkage, it's dynamic shrinkage, but we can measure it with sensors. Then what happens then in the evening? We are here at night, because you see that there is no sap flow, no transpiration. So the tree is resting. But and you see that during the evening, when the transpiration stops, let's say, there is still a little bit of water uptake by the roots, and that water refills the internal water reserve. So you have a shrinkage and a swelling every day. But then something very special happens, because during the night, you see that the swelling is more than the shrinkage, because we had a shrinkage of more or less 40. Now we have a swelling of 60. So that means that about 20 micrometers extra come with the signal. And that means that at that moment in time, so during the night, the tree is growing. So that means indeed, you hear it correctly, that trees grow and plants grow during the night due to the water relations, due to turgor. So it's a turgor-driven growth. And then, of course, you need the sugars that are produced during the day for creating this turgor and also for having building materials to keep the dimensional change of the cells in the way they are. So you see that we can reveal the mysteries of the plants by detailed measurements and continuous measurements. So every day, every moment of the day, you can have a look at how the plant is performing. So that means also that we can detect drought stress. So trees do respond to drought and quite fast. So here you see, for example, a data set where you see a control plant and a drought stress plant. Here, this point, the second line, well, the first line maybe. The first line is where there was no water supply anymore to the plant. The second line that you see here is where we as human beings see visual signals of signs of drought stress. So a little bit wilting of the leaves, let's say. So at that moment we give water and then you see that the plant, that it rehydrates very fast and then takes over again the normal pattern of shrinkage, swelling, growth, shrinkage, swelling, growth. You also see that here. But we as humans, we see that there is something wrong with the plant at this moment. But as you can see, these sensors give already information about what is going on 7 days before that we can see it as humans. And therefore, remember, those who can see the invisible can do the impossible. So that means that we can save our tree, our plants, faster than what we can, than when we would only look at it and have the visual symptoms. So therefore, this kind of sensors, they allow us to develop early warning systems. We can let them speak through interpretation of these signals. And like I said, in TreeWatch, we also have these tweeting trees. And this was, for example, an article in a newspaper where the trees of TreeWatch that they tweet for climate to announce whether indeed our trees have stress and go into mortality, yes or no. So that illustrates a bit the power of these sensors. In the meantime, we also have a citizen science project called CITRI. And basically, that is also a dendrometer. So similar as what you see here. Of course, here we have continuous data and therefore these daily patterns. But in our citizen science project, we allow the people to read how large the diameter is. And by that, they help us to interpret and to understand how, for example, city trees are behaving. And there is a huge interest in that also because the cities have to become greener, but there is not a lot of data available out there on urban situations, real measurements, and therefore we contribute with that, both with the TreeWatch system as well as with the band dendrometer that you see here to this question. Okay, then we move on. Because the same concept can also be used in vertical forms. And our vertical form, you see it here in the picture, and it's called the Agrotopia greenhouse. So it's 12 meters high, the largest one in Europe at the moment. So that means that we can have vertical form, multi-layer growing systems indoors in this greenhouse. And as a research group, I belong to the UGent Agrotopia Endowed Chair. That means because our faculty together our faculty receives research money, let's say, to research topics in the context of vertical farming. So if you want to have a look, I put here also the website, but if you type in Google, you get Agrotopia and our chair, you find all the details in case you would be interested in this topic. So what do we do? We use novel technology. We, of course, use the plant sensors due to the fact that we can interpret them their story and can create early warning systems With it, we also connect the sensors with models, as you will see in a minute. And in the end, we are able basically to create a virtual reality. Here you see that within the context of Agrotopia, we are testing novel LED lights. Basically, I saw before the talk start that there was a kind of a disco playing in the background. Well, basically, with this new LED technology, you can mix the right light. You can have this disco effect, let's say, for plants and mix indeed, depending on development of the plant and the spectral characteristics of the plant, you can give them the proper light. So that is something that we research in the lab and within this Agrotopia endowed chair. Second are sensors. So we hook up subflow sensors and dendrometers and clips. Here you see, for example, a phytoclip on a wheat plant and on a lettuce plant, but we also install these sensors, these dendrometers on fruit, so we can monitor all plant organs, let's say. Also, subflow sensors go from are miniaturized. So here you see a subflow sensor, a mini subflow sensor on a wheat crop. And so that means that we can follow continuously their behavior. So that means it's definitely in the context of horticulture, the speaking plant concept, because maybe you have heard of it. That means basically that we let the plant speak and dictate how the climate should be regulated. This concept is already out there for many years, but still people are trying to put things together. But it's definitely towards the future and a concept that will become reality. So again, plant as a biological indicator. So here you see, for example, the online plant monitoring system, subflow sensor and a dendrometer. Here you see how it is connected to a tomato plant. And then we can continuously follow the plant behavior in a software called PhytoSense. And that is how it looks like. So you can follow the subflow on a daily basis. Continuously, you can follow the growth pattern. And then we can derive, for example, the daily growth rate from it, maximum daily shrinkage, and that gives all information on how the plant is performing, and of course also the daily water use. So this plant, for example, consumed 1.9 liters, which is maybe more feasible for drinking this evening than the 40 or 30 liters before. Okay, then, like I said, we also combine the sensors with models. And you see here correctly, it are mechanistic plant models. So that means that the mechanisms, how the plant is functioning, that is behind the model. So we do understand, or the models, they give us insight in how the plant is working. So it are the mechanisms that we implement. And by combining the sensors together with models, we then can create control algorithms. For example, this is the schedule of STACI, the software tool for automatic control of irrigation. So this software tool gives us when and how much water has to be applied. And we compare that with traditional, based on for example, radiation irrigation schedules. And we could save with the plant-based irrigation something like 40% of water. And of course, knowing that water becomes scarce more and more, you understand that these kind of applications are important also towards the future. So that brings us then to Agrotopia. We built basically a virtual greenhouse, as you can see here. And then also the crops are modeled in 3D. So that we have virtual plants that grow from a seed up to a crop that can be harvested. So we call it the virtual reality. And here you see an example of a tomato crop fully modeled. So it looks like a movie in reality, but it is a model that is running here. And what do we do with that? For example, optimal design, because in horticulture, there are questions about, okay, we want to use LED lamps, but where do we need to put them? And here you see a scenario of top lights. Then we create the virtual environment. Our plant is behaving like a real plant, and we can monitor the light absorption. So if you hang the lamps at the top, you see that the light absorption is high at the top and low at the bottom. And if we calculate them and we compare it to no light, then in this scenario, you have a positive photosynthesis. So positive photosynthesis means that there will be sugars available for growth of the plant. So that is a positive thing. If now the same lamps are put between the plants, interlights, that is called, then you see that the light absorption is differently. And in that case, you pay the same amount of money, but you don't have an effect or hardly any effect in comparison to no light. So in that situation, instead of indeed paying for the lights, you can then decide as a grower, okay, this will not work and I will not invest in that. Or I will buy and I put them at the top of my crop. So you can do optimal designs of your greenhouse with these kind of measurements and functional structural plant models or 3D plant models as they are known. Here you see also a cool movie of a soybean plant growing from a small plant up to a plant that can be harvested. And the cool thing is, well, first of all, it just looks cool. Therefore, I like to show it. But the nice thing is also that all the leaves and the plant behaves like an actual plant. So that means that it responds to the climate as an actual plant will do. And that gives us, of course, opportunities for then applying that and steering the climate in horticulture. So that means indeed here another example on pepper plants where you also see between the plants the installation of the sensors. So that is basically a combination of sensors, modeling, novel technologies to create unique production systems. And that brings me then to the last couple of slides, because the same technique, these unique production systems, one of those is, for example, growing crops in space in spacecrafts. So in the lab, we are involved in a large project with many partners, as you can see. And Puratos is the coordinator of the project. And they are a bread baking company. And they were, in fact, saying, OK, we as a bread baking company, we want to be the first ones that bake bread on Mars. And of course, if you want to do that, you need wheat. And therefore, they contacted several partners for several tasks, and they contacted us to run their closed growing system to produce the wheat. So in that project, we are responsible for growing the wheat up to a crop that can be harvested, but that we can also say something about the quality of the grains, because of course that is important also for Puratos to make then all kinds of products with it. So therefore, indeed, this Mars Bakery, as you can see here, is already into the virtual world, as you can see. So a virtual system is used. We use a lot of sensors to really understand well the performance of wheat indoor, because that is not a logical choice. Normally, most people, they use lettuce. So it is a challenge, but working fine. And also there, we developed these virtual 3D plant models. And so by the end of the project, we hope to have this tool available that can help production of food in any kind of closed environment. And maybe they will use it then indeed up in their journeys to certain planets. And maybe, who knows, it will indeed work on Mars, and that this system will be used to bake the first bread on Mars. And basically, that is what I prepared. So here you will see my contact details. And if you have any questions, you can contact me here. But I will now stop sharing so that I can see you. And I'm sure that there will be questions which I am happy to answer.
Thank you.